We're living in a really exciting time, right? I mean, come on, we can stream everything. We've got smart everything. We've got Apple Pay, bioscanners, autonomous cars. And who would have thought? My new best friend, Alexa. Those innovations that we're experiencing and a whole cadre of other useful and some not so useful innovations are all part of the emphasis we've been putting on STEM education. You know, science, technology, engineering, and math. We poured into the basic sciences like physics and biology and chemistry and mathematics. And then we're leveraging that knowledge into applied sciences, things like engineering, medicine, agriculture, and even computer science. And we've seen even new fields emerge out of that, genomics and computational social science and data science. You see, we have made a significant investment through the federal government. Almost $3 billion per year goes into STEM education. And they're great initiatives. They're things like teacher education and buildings and equipment and scholarships, with the goal of graduating 1 million new STEM graduates over a 10-year period. Now, we're already seeing the benefits of that STEM investment. We're seeing great improvements in solar technology and wind technology for energy generation. We've got nanotechnologies now in medicine that can deliver medications to specific tumors. We've got corn and wheat that can grow in drought conditions. Those benefits are awesome. The problem is that right now we're starting to experience the fourth industrial revolution. Now, the first industrial revolution was driven by the steam engine. And the second industrial revolution came about based on mass production. And the third industrial revolution was the explosion of computer technology. I believe right now we're seeing the fourth industrial revolution, and what's driving it is disruptive technologies. Things like AI, machine learning, robotic process automation, and Internet of Things. And it's changing the way we live. The problem is that it's the knowledge we have and the degrees we've earned and the experience we have is extremely necessary. But it's not sufficient for success when dealing with disruptive technologies. We need additional skills that can put that technology to work. You've all met those people. You meet those really, really smart people, but you got to keep them locked away in a cubicle because they don't work and play well with others, right? I was talking with a business owner. He was telling me about his tech company, and he had a computer genius there. And the computer genius could fix anything related to databases. Well, pretty soon, the customers wanted to meet this superhero. So they started to bring him out to the customer meetings. Well, it didn't go so well, right? Because the computer genius, he didn't want to talk to other people. He was argumentative. He didn't want to listen. He didn't want to talk through problems and find new solutions with the customer. He didn't last there very long. Because companies today don't have the luxury of keeping around really smart people that don't have the critical skills necessary to really work with other people. So while I was convinced of all of the powerful, those additional skills that were out there and the need for those skills, I really wasn't sure what they were. So I went out and talked to other industry people. And they were equally supportive that there were these other skills that people really needed in order to be successful, but there was no consistency in what those skills were. Some said that, oh, it's communication, and it's emotional intelligence, and it's teamwork. And others said, no, it's really about individual skills like maturity and time management and loyalty and ethics. So while I was really convinced the importance of these other skills that we're all supposed to have, I was incredibly frustrated because no one could really nail down what those skills were. In fact, we didn't even have a consistent name for what those skills were. Some people called them professional skills, and some people called them non-technical skills, and some people called them transitional skills and transformational skills, and worst of all is probably soft skills. I call them critical skills because no matter what you want to name them, they're the skills that are critical for our success today. So two colleagues and I undertook the challenge of trying to figure out exactly what those skills were. So we went to a large online job advertisement database, and we extracted jobs for a US city for a 30-day period, anything for engineers. We figured engineers was a good place to start because it has such a core knowledge base. We ended up extracting 82 jobs, and they were across chemical engineering, electrical engineering, and industrial engineering, all the different engineerings you can imagine. And sure enough, those jobs each called for degrees in certain types of engineering and certain numbers of years of experience. But what we were really looking for was what were those additional skills specifically that you needed in order to be a successful engineer. So we used software and we dug through those job descriptions to pull out those skills. And we identified the top five skill areas that engineers need in order to be successful. 42% of those job descriptions listed a communication skill. 35% listed problem solving. 34% listed managing information. Another 34% listed project management. And 30% listed teamwork. Now it actually goes beyond that because those were the big ones. There were actually 28 different individual skills that engineers needed. And they were those individual specific items to a person, like their ethics, their ability to follow direction, their work ethic, their time management skills. But they were also skills that we used to communicate with each other, things like listening and cultural sensitivity. And then there were all other set of skills that you deal with when you're in groups, like leadership and delegation and negotiation. And what we came away with was, well, hold it. These aren't skills that you really necessarily learn in an engineering class. But the big takeaway was, those aren't just skills for engineers. Those are skills for every one of us that are dealing with a technology-driven world. I believe that we can be winners in this new fourth industrial revolution. But we're going to need to understand those disruptive technologies, and we're going to need to apply the critical skills that we need in order to make them effective. It's knowledge plus critical skills. It's both of them together. I met a guy the other day, and it was at a dinner, and he was an astrophysicist. Turns out he was a leading expert on exoplanets. I had no idea what an exoplanet was. So, of course, I went to my trusty phone. And it was so cool because I don't have to just put it in. All I have to do is tell it, what's an exoplanet? And it tells me that we've already discovered 3,000 of them out there. And they're real planets. They're out there circling distant stars. And not only can we find them these days, but we have the technology to understand what they're made of and if they'll potentially sustain life. That's the kind of world we're living in right now, with that kind of transformational and disruptive technology. So if we're going to be winners in this, how are we going to get those critical skills that we need? Well, first is we need to admit that those critical skills are really critical. And our study identified 28 of them. But then we did a second study to look across disciplines, not just engineering, and our list grew from 28 to 55. Now, there's no expectation that we all need all 25 or all 55 critical skills. But we're going to need some of them. And we need to start early. So at the K through 12 level, we need to start those basic skills. We need to start students early on learning discipline, responsiveness, responsibility, communication skills, and respect for others. In higher ed, we need to look at our specific disciplines, whether that's business or computer science or math or any of the sciences, whatever our area is, we need to look at that discipline and determine what critical skills our students are going to need for success. For businesses, each organization needs to look at those skills and decide which ones are important for their context. Because these critical skills are all about the context, where you work, what you're involved in, what's the pace, what are you trying to achieve? And there's a set of skills that'll help you do that. But companies are going to need to figure out what those are for their individual organization and then provide the training and the support to build up people's strengths. And for us as individuals, we need to look at our context. And we need to get serious about figuring out what soft skills we're going to need, what critical skills we're going to need for success. You see, I think we can be winners in this. Those disruptive technologies like AI, machine learning, and Internet of Things, and robotic process automation, they're here, and there's going to be even more introduced in the coming years. And we're going to have to wrestle with those, and we're going to have to apply the critical skills that can make them actually useful.